If you've used the navigation feature on your smartphone or your tablet, you must have made use of this IC, which is electronic compass, which is located on the printed circuit board of most of the modern smartphones nowadays. And what it does, is that it's a three-axis electronic compass, which helps you resolve the Earth magnetic field and measure it along X, Y, and Z axis, and that can help you determine whether you're facing north or you're facing south or you're facing east or you're facing west. Now, one might wonder that why do I need all the three axes? Because if I look at the analog version of a compass, usually I hold it flat with respect to the ground, and I only need to resolve this along the X and Y axis and not the Z axis. So that is the case, that is in fact the case, if you hold your phone only horizontally while using navigation. But if you don't want to dictate that to the user and you want to enable him to hold the phone in whatever way he likes, and still use these navigation feature enabled by the compass, then you often need to resolve this magnetic field along X, Y, and Z axis. As you can see, once you hold the phone vertically, the Z axis and the X axis are now interchanged. So you do in fact need a three-axis magnetic compass. And you might also need to use it in conjunction with the accelerometer to actually tell along which orientation you are holding the phone. And many a times you might also use it in conjunction with the GPS data. And one of my favorite use cases are these augmented reality based apps, which I often use. Like, for example, if you go to a famous tourist landmark, you can open this app and it would overlay what you're seeing and leverage the GPS data along with this compass data to actually tell you which direction you are facing. And then it can overlay this image and tell you that, you know, some of the details about this landmark and so on. So that's enabled by a combination of multiple of these sensors, the compass plus accelerometer, to tell you which direction you are facing, and then the GPS as well as imagery data to actually enable these augmented reality kind of applications. So now, let's talk about some of the basics, that how do these electronic compass actually work. So before I do that, let me name some of the players which are active in this electronic compass space. And there are multiple of technologies, there are multiple of ways through which you can measure and resolve this magnetic field. So the very first of them is this Japanese company called AKM Microelectronics, and it's in fact the incumbent. It has, as we speak, like close to or higher than 90% market share, and it makes these compass which are based upon the Hall effect, and I'll talk more to that in just a second. There are some of these other players which are competitors to AKM, and they make these compass which are based on the magnetoresistance effect, or specifically the anisotropic magnetoresistance. So in these companies, Honeywell, Sensitech, etc., they used a material which is often like a combination of iron and nickel, and the resistance of this material changes depending upon the magnitude of the magnetic field and also the angle of the magnetic field with respect to this resistor. But as I said, majority of the market is dominated by these Hall effect based sensors. And if I think about it, I'm actually quite amazed that these actually work, because if you think of a smartphone, it has a lot of features which generate quite a lot of magnetic field, and all of that is picked up by these electronic compass. So if I think about a smartphone, it would often have a speaker, okay, which generates or is actuated by a magnetic field. It often has a vibrating motor, which is a lot of times generates a lot of magnetic field. Besides that, there are a lot of like other chips like a Bluetooth antenna and so on, which also generate magnetic field, and all of these are picked up by this electronic compass. So it's actually quite commendable that it's still able to work under this environment, which has a lot of these magnetic generating components. Okay, so now how does the Hall effect work, and how is it leveraged inside these sensors? So Hall effect, as you might recall from your high school physics, it says that whenever you have current flowing through this slab, it would generate, and when you subject that to a magnetic field, it results in development of this Hall voltage, which is perpendicular to both the direction of the current and the magnetic field, and its magnitude, it's proportional to the magnetic field, and it's proportional to the amount of current that you're flowing. And the underlying physics behind that is the Lorentz force, which says that if you have a moving object which is subjected to a magnetic field, it experiences this Lorentz force. So for example, if you have an electron which is moving in this particular direction with the velocity v, when you subject it to a magnetic field which is perpendicular to it, it experiences this Lorentz force, which tries to deflect this electron along this path, and that in turn results in accumulation of electrons along this particular subsurface of this slab, and it would result in accumulation of positive charges along the other surface. And that in turn will generate an electric field which negates this Lorentz force, and because of that you get this Hall voltage. So this is what is used to resolve this magnetic field and find its magnitude. So shown here is one of the early sensors which was developed by Akamai to measures the magnetic field along the X, Y, and Z axis. And it consists of three of these sensors. Two of them are located in the plane, and the third one is located perpendicular to them. And they're all located perpendicular to each other such that you can resolve the magnetic field along X, Y, and Z direction. But as you can imagine, fabricating these three sensors, one of them is out of plane, is usually a challenging task. Also, it's subjected to a lot of errors related to alignment and making the placement exactly orthogonal and so on. So it's preferred if we can kind of achieve that by placing the sensors just in the plane of the chip, and then we can leverage some of the techniques we know from CMOS technology to make these sensors as well. So an element which is necessary to enable that is this piece of magnet called as a magnetic concentrator. So a magnetic concentrator is usually placed right on top of these sensors as shown over here. And these sensors are placed at the edge of these of this magnetic concentrator. So shown here is this magnetic concentrator, and then over at the edges, I have four of these Hall sensors, which are located underneath this magnetic concentrator. So what this magnetic concentrator does is that it takes these in-plane components of the magnetic field, the X and Y components. So if this is the X component of the magnetic field, it takes that and concentrates that so that it now takes it and bends that magnetic field line and makes it a perpendicular component now. So if I take this magnetic concentrator and if I think along the sensors at the position X1, so at this particular position, this X component, would be acting in conjunction with the Z component, and its direction would be such that they are acting along the same direction. On the other side of this magnetic concentrator, since these field lines are going around these magnetic concentrator, if it's coming out of the field on this sensor, it would be going down the field on the other side of this magnetic concentrator. So it would act as in addition to the Z component along one of the sensors, and would add in a subtractive manner on the other sensor. Okay, so these two sensors, which are now located on the edge of the magnetic concentrator, one of them sees this particular magnetic field perpendicular to the surface. The other one sees this magnetic field perpendicular to the surface. Similarly, for the Y component as well, one of them would see addition of the Y component and the other one would see subtraction of the Y component. So now by measuring these Hall sensors, I can add and subtract the output from these, and that would help me in resolving the individual X and Z field using these two sensors, and the Y and the Z field using, again, these two sensors. So this is how you can use you can then leverage, in fact, CMOS technology to make these individual Hall sensors. And what you can do is you can, for example, let's say you can start with a P-type substrate, and then you can implant it such that you create a N well, and then you can confine the flow of your electrons in this N well, and when you apply a perpendicular magnetic field, it would result in development of a Hall voltage, which is perpendicular to the direction of the current flow. So shown here is this chip from AKM, which shows again these this electronic compass die. And one of the features to notice is this magnetic concentrator, which is often placed right on top of the die. And if we take a zoom in look on this magnetic concentrator, it looks like this. So it consists of this piece of iron nickel, which is placed right on top of the die. And my Hall sensors, my X and Y sensors, which are located in the plane just at the edge of this magnetic concentrator. So to show that, I'm showing over here a top view. And in this particular picture, you can clearly see the individual Hall sensors. So these are the individual Hall sensors, and I would maybe use these two electrodes to flow current along this direction, and then I can sense the voltage by using these two electrodes, which are perpendicular, and I can measure the Hall voltage across them. And this blue circle over here, it's showing me where the magnetic concentrator, it would overlay on the top of this die. Okay, so if I do it this way, I can make my chip, and this is you know, my sensor which utilizes this magnetic concentrator, and I can make this sensor in a much smaller form factor as compared to the case where I would have to use three of these sensors, one of them located out of plane. Okay, so I can reduce my form factor as compared to that other approach. And form factor is in fact very important. Even though these dies are not the biggest dies on the surface of your phone, there are the memory chips and the microprocessor are of course much bigger, but making them smaller does make a difference, and you can see that trend over here where every year it shows when these sensors were introduced and also how they have been scaling in terms of footprint for these mobile devices. And the footprint does matter, and now you know, most of these footprints are trying to reach this 1 mm square kind of limit for my accelerometer, for my compass. And the other trend is you're using them in conjunction. So nowadays, you're seeing these gyroscopes, okay? And then the accelerometer would be placed on top of this, and the magnetic compass would be, you know, again be placed on top of it, both to reduce the form factor, and it also enables you to make use of just one ASIC or just one chip, which you can then use to process the signals from these three sensors, all of which are used for the purpose of motion sensing or inertial measurement unit. So you might also hear these terms, 9-axis or 6-axis. What that means is 9-axis means that, you know, you're using 3-axis from the accelerometer, you're using 3-axis of data gathered from your gyroscope in combination with the 3-axis of data gathered from your magnetometer or your magnetic compass. So we'll talk more about how these chips are placed on top of each other and some of the innovations which are happening in the field of packaging in another video. So see you in the next video.